body grows bigger.
Your mind must flower.
It's great to learn,
'cause knowledge is power.
It's Schoolhouse Rocky, a chip on the clock. On your favorite Schoolhouse, Schoolhouse Rock.
Come on, let's follow them down to that place of renown. They call it the Conjunction Junction Diner. With Schoolhouse Rocky and friends, you know the fun never ends. 'Cause everyone's a Schoolhouse Rock headliner.
Extra!
Rocky gets the diner cooking in short order when he reads that video jukebox and nickels, dining quarters.
Conjunction Junction, what's your function? Working up multiplication to music. Rocking with grammar and science and history.
Music on the menu, learning's really no mystery.
When you're in Conjunction Junction,
what's your function?
Picking up some knowledge, rocking round the clock. Accumulating power, watch your Schoolhouse Rock.
Hey chef, what's special today?
The Dunce Chicken Fingers with a side of the top 10 worst Schoolhouse Rock songs. Hello, and welcome to the Movie Universe. I'm your host, Movie Fan. Well, as I'm sure you've already figured out, today we got something real special lined up for you, and that would be the top 10 worst Schoolhouse Rock songs. Now, before we get started, I want to introduce my good friends, Bonnie from Joy Unicycle, Alpha Lion Simba, and of course, Joshua Oro, the Mustang Prince.
Hi, everybody. It's me again. So great to see you guys again.
Hey, guys, and thanks for having me, Movie Fan.
Hey guys, what's up? Alpha Lion Simba here from Alpha's Animal Kingdom, and I'm back on the Movie Universe.
Always great to have you guys here.
A Movie Fan, are you sure you want to do this?
Yes, Bonnie, I do. Why do you ask?
Mainly because if we try to do a top 10 worst Schoolhouse Rock list, we are very likely to get some very unfriendly interjections.
Ah, that's my favorite.
Oh, come on! That song is a classic.
Hooray! Someone finally said something.
Interjections generally set apart from it. Oh, I must have gotten carried away. Sorry. But you know what I mean. You sure you want to do this?
Yes, Bonnie, I'm sure I want to do this, because to the best of my knowledge, no one has ever done this before. They always talk about, you know, classic episodes of Schoolhouse Rock and all that, but nobody has ever decided to ask which ones are really the worst in the whole lineup. And because that's never been done before, I want to be the first one to do it, and I definitely want you guys along with me, because, well, this is too big of an opportunity to pass up.
Remember, knowledge is power.
Well, as much as I love Schoolhouse Rock, I do admit that not a lot of these songs are perfect. In fact, there are a few that I do have mixed feelings about.
Okay, let's do it.
I'm ready whenever you guys are, I hope.
When it comes to Schoolhouse Rock, I'm always ready. But first, we need to take a minute to do a little history lesson. Now, for those of you who aren't aware, it all started back in the 70s when an advertising executive named David McCall noticed that his son was having a hard time trying to memorize the multiplication table. However, he noticed that he had no trouble memorizing songs from the Beatles and the Rolling Stones and so on. So, he decided to try and create a song that would teach his son and possibly some other kids to learn the multiplication table. He enlisted the help of creative director George Newall and Bob Dureau to create a song that would teach about the multiplication table. And that song would become
3 is a magic number.
Along the way, an illustrator named Tom Yohe, who worked for McCall, heard the song and created some visuals to accompany it. Afterwards, Radford Stone, who was the producer of ABC, decided they should pitch a TV series for it. And it shortly caught the attention of Michael Eisner, who was the senior vice president of the production of ABC at the time. And the rest became history.
Over the years, Schoolhouse Rock has given us songs from multiplication, grammar, science, history, computer, money, and the latest volume to date, Earth Rock.
Now, to make our decisions, we had to base it on, well, basically the videos themselves. Number one, how memorable is the song? Number two, how catchy is it? And number three, do you really learn anything out of this? Now, let us get started with number 10 I'm gonna send your vote to college. Now, I'm gonna send your vote to college is a little more new because it came out in 2002 to explain about the Electoral College. Hence the title, I'm gonna send your vote to college. This is on the list because one, the song is not very memorable at all. And two, you do learn a bit about how this system works. However, that's where it really falls flat on its face. And that's due to the fact that how this really works is the Electoral College makes the decision on who's going to be president. And they do kind of acknowledge that, but not very well. Mostly due to the fact that it hasn't been until, well, fairly recently that the truth really came out on the fact that our vote is worthless. Now, I've talked about this once before in my How to Save America video, and I'll try not to get all preachy and political here because, you know, I don't want to go into that kind of detail, but I will get to the nitty-gritty. And that is the fact that our vote is basically worthless. The truth is, the Electoral College makes the call. And the sad truth is, it really goes like this. The fact that if there's more Republicans in the college per state, who do you think they're going to vote for? They're not going to vote for the Democrat who's running because they're going to vote for the Republican just because it's their party. And if there's more Democrats in that college in every state, or at least the majority of them, of course, then who do you think they're going to vote for? The animation is good, actually. It's actually pretty good, but this whole sequence is pretty dull, and unfortunately, like I said, the song is not very memorable at all.
Fun fact, this song was created in response to the controversial 2000 election in which the Electoral College went against the popular vote for the first time since 1888. Now, from my perspective, this song is not that bad, but I agree with MuyiFan that it's not very memorable. Also, one of the verses kind of feels pretty long, which is between the bit where Boothie makes his entrance and where the cheerleaders give their second cheer.
Oh boy, this is gonna be a college that I'm bound to fail, and no thank you, I'd rather not have my vote in it. Because this song, it tries too hard to compare the Electoral College with an actual college. Even on a visual level, the visuals just aren't that impressive with this song. Especially with the map. I mean, it's just random speckling of red and blue altogether. The lyrics are cheesy, and for me, the tune is forgettable. So, yeah, you got my vote of no.
Number 9, 750 once a week. Okay, let me start this off by saying that this one's kind of a new discovery for me, to be honest, because the fact is, for some reason, this was never aired in my area. Why? I don't know. But I got the DVD, and I've been watching it, and, well, I'm not too impressed with it, I hate to say. I can appreciate what it's going for, but at the same time, it feels kind of weak to me. The main issue I have is the song's not very catchy, at least not to me anyway. Like I said, I can appreciate what they're going for, but it doesn't stick with me. And as we all know, most of the Schoolhouse Rock songs, you know, they stick with you. You know them like the back of your hand. This one, it doesn't give me much to work with at all. It's not very memorable, and I don't know what it is, but it sounds like our singer's not putting too much effort into this one. Like it was just kind of done on the fly.
Okay, so, I'm finding myself defending this one a little bit more. And to be fair, when we say worst on the list, we don't necessarily mean the worst of the worst, but more like the weakest. And I don't think this is among the weakest, but I don't think it's among the strongest either. But I think this is a really good song. It talks about getting paid $7.50 a week and what this kid uses the entire $7.50 a week for. And it encourages kids how to be cautious with what you're given and what you're paid, and whether it be a $3 allowance or even your paycheck in the mail when you grow up. How are you going to spend it? Are you going to save it? Are you going to put some away? Are you going to spend it on something you like? Are you going to compare prices before it's too late. It presents all these different issues, and I think it's actually a good one. And I know that math rock is different from money rock, but in all honesty, I think they go very much hand in hand. So this should have been more of a math rock than a money rock. That way, you could know the subtraction, the addition. So, like, if the kid decided to spend half of $7.50 a week and then save the other half for the following week, and then that half plus the next $7.50 a week, what does he have now? So basically, this is a math problem, but I appreciate it for that, and I appreciate it for encouraging kids to spend it wisely.
You know, Bonnie, I actually kind of agree with you about this song. Yes, it's not one of the strongest songs in Schoolhouse Rock history, but I do like what it discusses, like money management, planning ahead, etc. And I like the household chores that the main character does to get more money, like washing the car, mopping the floor, or cleaning up the backyard. However, there's one thing that kind of boggles me. You see, during the song, we see the kid paying $2.50 for an ice cream sandwich, which gives him $5 left. Later, he spends 60 cents for a pack of bubble gum, which equals $4.40, and then $2 for a chicken enchilada, which equals $2.40. But the song doesn't really say what he spends the rest on before he goes broke. Also to note, I thought the silliest parts of the song are the parts where the kid falls down a tube and goes up the creek, and the part where he balances his budget before it crashes to the floor at the end of the song. By the way, am I the only one who thinks that the main character looks almost like TJ Detweiler from the Recess series?
I don't know, Joshua. I never thought about that before. Now that you mention it, there is a pretty good resemblance. Number 8. Dollars and Cents. Now, I'll be honest with everybody. I actually do like this song. It's actually pretty catchy, and it's got a good country western vibe to it. I actually do like that. However, at the same time, it kind of sets a little bad example. Now, the point of this video is to show about, you know, I could make some money either by depositing in the bank in a savings account and earn interest from that, or get a loan. Of course, you got to pay it back with interest. And I got to give the banker credit for this one. He was very thorough. Just take a look.
Why not deposit them dollars in the bank instead? Then at the end of the year, you come out way ahead, because the bank will pay you money in exchange for the use of your cash. And that's called interest. You're making money that way, and you can buy that gear about a year from today. Why, sure, Becky Sue, I can give you a hint. I can lend you the money, but you must understand, when you borrow from the bank, then you gotta pay it back on time. And when you're done paying back every dollar that's due, you will find you paid them back a little extra too. For every dollar you borrow, you gotta pay the bank a dollar and a dime. Again, that's interest, and it's just a fee you pay to use the money that you borrow from me.
Like I said, he was very thorough about this, so he makes it very clear, and I applaud him for that one. However, at the same time, it does give a bad example about getting loans, because truth be told, whenever anybody gets a loan from the bank, they really kind of pay through the nose. It has happened before. Now, granted, sometimes you don't have a choice. Like, for instance, if you need a new car because your old one just went kaput. But the problem is, Becky Sue does have a choice, because she could wait, and that's a key thing. Or she could just get herself an acoustic guitar. And when she gets a loan from the bank and buys all this stuff, apparently she has no electricity at her place, so she can't use it. So she clearly did not think this through. But anyway, it does kind of set a bad example about getting loans, because truth be told, you definitely don't want to just jump on that. Because, you know, you do pay, and I mean pay. So that's my issue with this video. Although, to be fair, the banker was very clear about this stuff, and he did say use a little common sense.
Now, from my perspective, Money Rock is not one of my favorite volumes in Schoolhouse Rock, even though there are some pretty good songs. And believe you me, Economics was the toughest subject I ever had to get through during my senior year of high school. Anyway, this song is another guilty pleasure for me, mostly due to the country music, and I find it pretty interesting that this is the only song from the Money Rock volume to be featured on the top 25 songs from the 30th anniversary Best of Schoolhouse Rock VHS.
Number 7, Fireworks. Now this one actually has potential. I mean, the music is not bad, but at the same time, a lot of it just seems to be kind of jumbled up, because unfortunately, they're pretty much telling you what you already kind of figured out when you saw the Shot Heard Round the World video. So, it's just basically repeating old news, for starters. And I'm not very fond of the two running gags that are going through this. The first one being the newspaper boy just appearing everywhere saying they did it and stuff like that. And then there's this running gag.
Said we had the right of life and liberty. And the pursuit of happiness. Of life and liberty. And the pursuit of happiness.
To life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
Yeah, that's kind of pushing it, don't you think? Because think about that for a minute, what was going on there. Although I will admit, it does have one really good moment, and that's right at the end when the kids are reading the Declaration of Independence.
We hold these truths to be self-evident,
that all men are created equal,
that they are endowed by their Creator
with certain unalienable rights,
that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
That was a great scene right there. I can't deny it. If it didn't have the pursuit of happiness gag, it would have been a lot better. But at the same time, moments like that, it's not very good, and it doesn't stick with you. And on top of that, this is another one that I don't remember them ever airing in my area at all. Maybe a lot of parents were not too thrilled about the pursuit of happiness scene. I don't know.
Now, I must say that this song is a guilty pleasure for me. In fact, I kind of make it a tradition to listen to this song every year when it comes close to the Independence Day weekend. And fan, I agree with you about the pursuit of happiness gag, because it's the very same problem that folks have with Pepe Le Pew, chasing women. Also, the parts where the newsie yells out his headlines kind of makes it pretty hard to hear some of the lyrics. Same goes for the part where Thomas Jefferson and the other people who signed the Declaration of Independence say here or present. My advice, listen to the soundtrack version for a better experience.
Well, the first thing I have to say about this is false advertising by a long shot. And this song is titled Fireworks, and it's about the Declaration of Independence. Oh, sure, we light off fireworks on the 4th of July, but this just doesn't seem to be the appropriate title for the song. I mean, if you're going to have a song called Fireworks on Schoolhouse Rock, why not just bunk it over to Science Rock and have it talk about how fireworks actually work? You know? Not to mention, when those kids are giving that big speech about what the Declaration of Independence towards the end was, doesn't really sound like they were giving a crap. And not to mention, the whole running gag of what they show during the pursuit of happiness, I have just one thing to say for that. You know, for kids.
Number 6. Preamble.
I can't really give too much defense about this song. I will be fair and nice and say that I like the banjo sound and how very bouncy it can be occasionally, and I think the singer is really good. Joshua, who did you say she was again?
I'm glad you asked, Bonnie. The singer for this song is Lynn Ahrens. For those who don't know, Lynn Ahrens is an American writer and lyricist for musical theater, television, and film, who has been collaborating with Stephen Flaherty for many years. Also, aside from singing and writing a few Schoolhouse Rock songs, She also got to write songs for Seussical the Musical, Don Bluth's Anastasia, and its spin-off, Bark Talk the Magnificent, Buster and Chauncey's Silent Night, and the 1994 stage musical of A Christmas Carol with Alan Menken, which later became a TV musical special in 2004.
Yeah, that's right. And she's really, really good. But that's about it with my defenses, because in all honesty, the main problem I have with this song is that it's too simple. I get it, kids and so forth simplify everything for them, but at the same time, I don't know, is it just me, or does it simplify America's history a little too much?
Yes, Bonnie, it does. It oversimplifies it way too much.
Yeah, I thought so. I know we need to simplify things for kids, but simplify them in groups, and preamble is generically simplified.
I couldn't agree more, Bonnie, because that is the biggest problem. It is way too simple, because the Constitution is way more complicated than that. And that's the truth. All we keep getting really out of this is, well, this part right here.
We the people, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare at hand, secure the blessings of liberty, to ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America.
If they wanted to teach something important about the Constitution, they should have taught some of the most basic amendments in there. And they don't. That's just it. They don't. Instead, they just keep reading the preamble. Now, sure, all the amendments in the Constitution, most of them are very complicated to read because they use such huge words that only a lawyer can understand them. However, there are still quite a few of them that we're all very familiar with, and they should have covered. Probably the most important one would be the First Amendment, which is freedom of speech, freedom of the press, freedom to protest, the freedom of religion. Why they never covered that, I don't know. Instead, we just keep reading the preamble. And as nice of a title as it is, that's not nearly as important as the amendments themselves, because the amendments are the laws of this country. So why they thought they should just avoid that, I don't know. Like I said before, many of them are hard to understand because they write them in such big words. But obviously the First Amendment would be a real easy one to cover. And it's the most important one of all. Number 5, the victim of gravity.
Sorry guys, I'm going to have to strongly disagree about this one and defend this. But before I do, go ahead and share why you say this should be on the list.
Well, to be honest, I wasn't really a big fan of this song when I first heard it while playing one of the Schoolhouse Rock CD-ROM games. And while 1950s doo-wop songs are kind of rare these days, I think what happens during this song is a bit over the top due to all the misfortune that David gets into. And I felt really bad when his girlfriend Mary Jean ditches him. And personally, I didn't think it was a strong song to end the science rock volume with. However, I do give this song credit for including Isaac Newton and Galileo Galilei's contributions to modern understanding of the concept of gravity.
Well, I'll be honest, I like the song, and I can't deny that it's really funny. However, that's kind of a double-edged sword, because as a kid, I watched this and I was busy laughing my head off the whole time. And I wasn't really getting the picture as to what this was all about. I mean, granted, it was obvious it was all about gravity, sure. But any lessons that were taught in this, I wasn't really paying attention. I was too busy laughing at every time Dave fell down and hurt himself. And then there's the scene where Dave's girlfriend, Mary Jean, just up and leaves. On the one hand, I can't help but laugh at this because, well, he literally does it like this.
The weaker the pull become. Come back, Mary Jean.
Now that's funny because he's trying to sound like John Travolta in Grease right there. But at the same time, The lesson at that moment was talking about how the further away an object is, the weaker the pull, and the closer an object is, the stronger the pull of gravity. And I'm just too busy laughing at that whole scene to pay attention. It's not a bad concept. The problem is the comedy overshadows what the video is all about. And that kind of defeats the purpose of learning about gravity.
Okay, now that that's taken care of, there's a couple of reasons why I think that this song is a lot better than given credit for. First of all, it teaches the lesson about gravity in kind of a funny way. And I think it's funny every time, but also kind of sad. The guy keeps falling and crashing every time and everything's crashing. It basically shares what gravity is, because it's one thing to look it up in the dictionary. It's quite another thing to see what gravity is and help explore what that is. And the images just get me laughing a lot of the time. And then there's the number one reason I strongly defend this. The singers. Apparently, they got the tokens on here. That's the tokens singing.
Hold on a second. No flippin' way! I never would have guessed that the tokens were the singers. That's some very interesting trivia there, Bonnie.
Of course, they're very well known for this famous song. Oh, okay, sorry guys, I got really carried away. But you would too. It's the tokens, for goodness sakes. That puts 30 points up for me. They sound amazing, and they went out of their way to do a Schoolhouse Rock song. Like I said in Rockadoodle, when you, movie fan, and I talked about Elvis's singers being in that show, the tokens didn't have to be in Schoolhouse Rock, but they wanted to. They volunteered for this, so the fact that they did that just out of pure kindness and care for education, that gives it 30 points for me. Enough said.
Number 4, the Energy Blues. When it comes to the Energy Blues, this is one of my least favorites, I'm not going to lie, because every time I watch this, I just can't get into it. In fact, growing up, this would come on every now and again. And I was always like, oh, not this one again. Because this does not give me much to work with. The only thing I could give it credit these days is a little historical perspective. You know, bringing up about mankind using coal and oil. But that's not much. And that's pretty much all I got for this one. Bonnie, what do you say about all this? Bonnie!
Oh, I'm sorry. What's going on?
We're talking about the Energy Blues.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Oh, I just listened to this song. So, what's the first thing I have to say about it? Well, take it away, Petrie.
It's boring, boring, very, very boring.
Oh my gosh. I don't think I can defend this one that much. There's a few things I can defend. Like, I think the animation is nice. Jack Sheldon singing. He's got a gorgeous voice, as usual, but... Oh man. No, I really cannot defend this. This is boring, this is dull, this is drawn out, and by the end of it, I really don't feel like I've learned anything. The only thing I've learned is turn the extra light off if you don't need it, don't waste energy, but really that's what it should have said in the first place, is don't waste energy, because if you do, you tire out the world. Okay. So make that one of the lyrics, and not just criticize the fact that people had to chop wood in order for homes to be made, or that dams have to keep running in order to help with energy. In fact, what part of Schoolhouse Rock was this from? One search later. Science rock? How is this not Earth rock? Because, I'm sorry, this very much feels like Earth rock, which I'm sure we'll talk about later. But this seems to address more about what to do with the environment, how to help save it and such. It feels less like science and more like Earth rock. And I'm clearly repeating myself. I'm just so bored by this. I'm sorry, guys. If you want your kids to learn how to save on energy, actually try talking them through it. I get why this song is intentionally boring, also why it's trying to be kind of slow, jazzy blues, but it just doesn't work for me. I don't expect it to be rock and roll. It doesn't have to be that, but at least try to do it in a way that's not going to put your kids to sleep. This just wore me out. And if it wears me, an adult, out, then it's going to wear a kid out too. And aside from turn off a lamp, that's not necessary. They're not really going to learn much from it. That's my two cents. What do you guys have to say about it?
Ugh, energy. Why must this song have a lack of energy? Yeah, that's something that I wish would be the only thing I could say about this song. But anyway, in my personal opinion, the energy blues is both meh and pretty forgettable. However, I thought the part involving the oil gusher eruption was very intense, and the gas station scene was really crazy.
Number 3. Them Not-So-Dry Bones.
On the one hand, I want to defend this song. Obviously, I don't think it's as bad as the previous song, but I do sense some missed opportunity with this song. From the title alone, you could tell what this is kind of parodying. And I say kind of because it barely parodies Them Dry Bones song. Most of you know how this song goes. Toe bone connected to the foot bone connected to the heel bone connected to the ankle bone. Now hear the word of the Lord, and so forth. But, this song does not take advantage of that opportunity to parody it. So, for instance, this is what they could have easily done, and forgive me if I don't phrase the bones correctly. They could have said something like, fibula bone connected to the tibia connected to the paltia connected to the femur, and so forth. Just looking at the diagram and showing what bones are which whilst singing it, and also sharing how these bones function. And I do give them credit for sharing how these bones function. However, there is one thing I cannot defend with this song. And unfortunately, I think it's a major flaw. Here we're going to replay one of the lyrics.
Look out! Here comes a bonehead plane! Burn his brain! Tweet, tweet, tweet! What a day! Don't take much to overwhelm it. But luckily, those bones up there work like a built-in helmet.
I think I'd need to call Dr. Cox for analysis. What do you say about it?
Wrong, 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 wrong. Wrong, 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 wrong. You're wrong. You're wrong. You're wrong.
Exactly. There's something majorly wrong with that because, yeah, the skull protects your brains, but it's still vulnerable, and a skull fracture is enough to cause damage and even death. So that's why we do things like actually wear helmets when we go bicycling or when we go motorcycling, which I still recommend. Put on a helmet! But yeah, I mean, it's things like that that actually protect you. So, yeah, the skull protects your brains, but it's still up for being cracked if something is strong enough to puncture it. So you want to be careful, and don't treat your head like an automatic helmet.
Now, I must be honest. While I have heard a lot of the science rock songs from the CD-ROM games before watching it on VHS, there were two that I was kinda new with. One being this song, and the other being Do the Circulation. And between those two, Them not-so-dry bones is my least favorite. Now, how do I put it? Yes, I do agree with the stuff that Bonnie said, but anyway, while I do like the Halloween reference at the beginning, along with the lesson about keeping your teeth clean, giving your bones calcium, and drinking milk, the thing that I find pretty weird is during this part.
Finest bones, you're just a blur! Being frameworks, their main job. All your organs, muscles too, they need your bones to hold them safe and sound inside for you.
Plus, while they identified the shin, knee, and thigh bones, they mentioned the femur, which brings back scary and frustrating memories from when a giant cell tumor put a golf ball-sized hole in my femur. I mean, seriously, why did that have to happen to me years ago? Also to note, why does the song's ending recycle a couple previously seen clips?
Well, I got nothing really I can add to this conversation, because Bonnie and Joshua, you guys covered it all very well, I might add. So pretty much the only thing I could say is I agree with you on all points, because, yeah, it is true. I mean, you do have to wear a helmet or else you're going to get a bad concussion. In fact, here's a newsflash for you. You ever heard the story about boxers getting brain damage from boxing? Well, that's because your brain literally bounces back and forth when you take a blow to the head. So the helmet idea, If it was a helmet, then it would be cushioned enough where that wouldn't happen. And granted, there is a kind of cushioning in there. It's kind of like a fluid, but it's not enough. And Joshua, I totally agree, because that ending, I never understood why they repeated those two scenes.
Oh, now we're in for the real stinkers.
Number 2, Little 12 Toes. This one is definitely one of my least favorite, I am not going to lie, because it takes too long to get to where we really need to go with this whole math problem here. Because if you watch this video, basically, it's just repeating this line over and over again.
Now, if man had been born with 6 fingers on each hand, he'd also have 12 toes, or so the theory goes. Now, if man had been born with 6 fingers on each hand, now if man had been born with 6 fingers on each hand.
And what's worse is they keep bringing up some pointless theories like this.
He probably would have invented 2 more digits when he invented his number system. If man had been born with 6 fingers on each hand, his children would have them too. And when they played hide-and-go-seek, they'd count by 6s fast. And when they studied piano, they'd do their 6-finger exercises. And when they went to school, they'd learn the golden rule and how to multiply by 12 easily. Just put down a zero. He'd probably count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, deck, L, do. Deck and L being 2 entirely new signs, meaning 10 and 11. Single digits. And his 12, do, would have been written 1-0. Get it?
Okay, for the record, I have tried to look that up to see if any mathematician ever uses the words deck, L, and do for 10, 11, and 12. And guess what? They don't. None of them do. Nobody talks like that. There is absolutely no rhyme, no reason, no purpose to this. All this deck-el-do crap is just nothing but a waste of time. Maybe even a hypothetical theory. Because I've tried looking it up. I couldn't find any information or any proof that any mathematician ever theorized this. So, all this was useless information. We're supposed to be learning how to multiply by 12 here, and all we keep getting is, if man had been born with 6 fingers, and if he would be able to do this, and of course, deck-el-do, which doesn't exist. It was nothing but a waste of time. You guys got anything you want to add to this?
Little 12 toes. It's catchy. I enjoy watching the animation and different forms and shapes that this alien can take, but This is my problem. Schoolhouse Rock, 12 toes. What do they have to do with each other? I get it. It's multiplication. It's talking about all the different ways you multiply by 12, but 12 toes? I think that each of us can come up with, off the top of our heads, a different way that 12 is important. So something like 12 hours makes half a day, and 24 hours, that's 12 times 2, makes a full day. What do you guys got?
12 eggs in a carton.
12 months in a year. How about this? Just rewrite the problem so that 12 is broken down into 10 and 2, and then apply the distributive property to make two separate multiplication problems, and then use the math tricks for multiplying by 10, add a zero at the end, and then multiply by 2 and double the number.
Yeah, there are better ways to count by 12s, like say, the 12 days of Christmas, the 12 disciples, but yeah, anything other than toes, dude.
See? All these different ways that 12 is relevant. What does 12 and toes have to do with each other unless you're Count Rugen from Princess Bride? But even then he had 6 fingers only on one hand, so that would make it 11. But 12 toes? Who thinks 12 and toes together? Again, why didn't you take any of these ideas that we just threw at you? That's my big issue with this, is how much of a missed opportunity it was. I did learn some multiplication from it. I will give it that. But it was all over the place and focused on an idea that little to nobody ever thinks of.
Now, I must confess, when I was first introduced to this song as a kid, it didn't really feel like a song at all. Mostly it felt like a creepy campfire story, mainly due to the music, which sounds a bit eccentric. And the part involving this handprint on the mailbox and these footprints, which then turn into a jump scare where we finally see what little 12 Toes looks like. I mean, he may be one of two Schoolhouse Rock characters who come from space, but design-wise, he kind of looks like a character from the Peanuts, with blue skin, a black and white striped hat with goggles, a black and white shirt with a gold star, white pants, and a white vest. Plus, he has the ability to disassemble parts of his body, and he flies around in this cool-looking space cruiser. Also, fan, I'd like to share a little tidbit regarding Deck and L. They're based on the numerals of the duodecimal system, which were devised by William Addison Dwiggins. Plus, the only time where we do learn to multiply by 12 during this song is at this scene, which lasts for about 33 seconds.
Before we move on, here are some dishonorable mentions.
Mother Necessity, where would we be?
The king could only see us now, he would be proud of us today. They knew that now they'd run their own land. But George III still vowed he'd rule them to the end.
Number 1, Earth Rock. Okay, now we have truly come to the worst. Like Bonnie said about the other ones that we covered so far, we don't necessarily hate them. They're just either a little weak or not very memorable. But this is truly the worst. This is gut-wrenchingly horrible beyond imagination, because Earth Rock is nothing more than global warming propaganda. And I can assure you, we're not talking about one song from the Earth Rock album. We're talking about the entire thing. Just take a little glimpse of some of this footage from the bumpers.
Make sure. Careful! That's the only Earth we've got. And we're from the Arctic Circle.
We're polar bears!
Yes, and
Well, we are.
Yeah, and as official spokesbearers on global warming, here's our intrepid ace cub reporter with a report on global warming. Now, what would you be thinking about,
I'm just imagining fish swimming through clear, pristine seas, living a happy and full life. I love fish.
I like fish too.
And now a word about energy from our recent past.
What do you mean?
The energy crisis, Jack. It's been with us for a while.
Oh, you mean the energy blues?
Exactly.
A classic, a blast from the past, a chart buster. But why are you taking the Earth?
It's the only Earth we've got.
If that's not propaganda, then I don't know what is, because that is clear-cut propaganda right there. It's just meant to cram down the idea of global warming's bad down your throat. And we're having a global warming problem. And if you think that's bad, wait to hear some of the songs. They are just so full of propaganda in the worst way that they are just constantly preaching and preaching about how bad global warming is. Just take a listen to this.
Good morning from the Arctic Circle. We've got your weather news today. We're reporting live from our North Pole station, overlooking Hudson Bay. You can call us your barometers, cause we don't need thermometers to bring you this early warning, so we can all fight global warming.
Mr. Morton wasn't famous or important, lived an ordinary little life. He had a son named Norton, a cat named Orton, and Pearl was his wife. Pearl liked to shower for about an hour. Little Norton never turned off lights. And as for Orton the cat, he wouldn't scat till they turned up the thermostat.
Sasquatch, Sasquatch.
For years this legend has been told of a creature seldom seen. He leaves a footprint so immense it could make a grown man scream. Sasquatch, Bigfoot, Yeti, he goes by all those names. But now there's something scarier and our world's not quite the same. There are beasts who are leaving footprints that make Bigfoot's track look small. And they're messing up our atmosphere, so heed this wake-up call. We call them carbon footprints and they're made of CO2. And who's leaving these big footprints? Well, I'm afraid it's me and you.
If you think that's bad, wait to see the rap version. Yes, folks, this really exists.
Two-thirds of the world is covered with ocean, and human pollution makes a big commotion.
This is pathetic. Absolutely, truly pathetic. The music just makes me want to cringe in the worst way. How they just keep preaching and preaching and preaching about global warming's bad, global warming's bad. And then there's the cliche story of,
that's the only Earth we've got. It's the only Earth we've got.
Oh, stop it. Stop it. Stop it. That line was tired then. It was even tired beforehand. Just listening to this, watching this, and even thinking about this makes me want to do what the Grinch does. Yeah, that's it right there. And just talking about this is giving me a serious migraine right now. Why don't you guys take over right now? I need to go get an aspirin.
Now, where do I begin with this tarnation? Well, back in 2009, the semester where I was about to graduate from high school and move on to college, I saw this volume being sold at my local Target store. And to be quite honest, I didn't really give it too much thought. But then, in 2020, during the whole blasted COVID-19 lockdown, Eli Stone, aka the cartoon hero, made his own Schoolhouse Rock review for his I'm Turning 30 trilogy, which was great and all. And while he did describe Earth Rock as okay, the part where he showed the rap song made me feel a bit uncomfortable. And I agree with Eli that including rap music in a series meant to educate kids was wrong. But that's not all. During the making of this project, I got to listen to a few of these songs on both YouTube and Kim Cartoon. And while listening and watching,
I felt that most of them weren't really that memorable to me, and they lacked the same educational charm that the older Schoolhouse Rock songs had. Plus, a couple of these songs feel like environmental sequels to classic songs like Interplanet Janet and The Tale of Mr. Morton, and the 3R song feels like a recycling parody of Three is a Magic Number, aka the very first Schoolhouse Rock song ever made. And of course, they replay the Energy Blues song, which we mentioned earlier. Also to note, Lynn Ahrens, the late Bob Juro, the late Jack Sheldon, and the late Schoolhouse Rock co-creator George R. Newell were involved as singers and songwriters for some of these preachy songs. If anything should be teaching me about global warming or saving the Earth, I'd rather listen to the Recycling Fiesta from Sticking Around, or watch films like Ferngully, The Last Rainforest, Once Upon a Forest, Dr. Seuss's The Lorax, Blue Skies Rio 2, or even Roland Emmerich's The Day After Tomorrow than these. Ugh. And it really makes me glad that Earth Rock is not available on Disney Plus.
Earth Rock. And I gotta agree with you, movie fan. For about most of these songs, I didn't find myself hating them. I did have critiques for some of them. Unfortunately for Earth Rock, this is pretty much... I will say that I don't hate all of the songs. Just a couple. Yes, believe it or not, guys, I do think that some of them are actually good.
What?
Yeah. I think some of them are good, but in order to compare, I'm pretty much going to go through my thoughts of the entire album, and I'll keep it to a few words as much as possible. But also to start with, I'm going to say that it's not uncommon to be talking about global warming and to be global warming propaganda. I still hate that my high school always dragged us to watch a lot of propos about global warming. I could not tell if they were trying to guilt trip us or if they were trying to help us be aware of how we can make things better. But either way, it was very confusing on what they were trying to do. I give the Lorax book credit for making us actually think about what we could do in order to keep the environment in balance, but also even makes us think about how to keep the economy in balance. This whole album is one-sided, and I don't appreciate it for that. So what did I think of each of these songs? Report from the North Pole. Report from the North Pole is just absolutely nothing. It's the intro to the album, and it's just guilt trip after guilt trip. The little things we do, I actually don't think is that bad. I do like that it's a sequel to The Tale of Mr. Morton. Very unnecessary, I'll admit. I do like the idea that it's encouraging kids to turn off what's not necessary. So if you've got an extra lamp or if you've got water running, turn it off when you don't need it. And to be fair, I do like hearing that Mr. Morton and Pearl have now had a son. So that's sweet. But otherwise, it's forgettable, in my opinion. And that's the nice thing I could say about it. Trash can bend. I do like the country theme, but then again, I like country music. Thank you, Charlie Daniels! At best, this song is okay. And it does teach about thinking twice before you throw something away. At worst, I don't think a lot of kids are gonna be singing along due to how fast it is and the speed. I couldn't even follow along with it that much. I tried listening to it. Tell me if you could follow along with it.
So play it smart, let's do our part by making less trash.
Reduce the trash that you produce.
One big bag, not six small ones.
Reuse the things you can reuse.
Think twice before you toss them.
Recycle, donate, buy things, use. It's a make less garbage plan.
Reduce,
reuse,
recycle.
With box and bottle and can.
I'm box,
I'm bottle,
I'm can.
The members of the trash can band.
I do applaud the theme of being able to reuse something. Heck, there's a Sesame Street book. I wish I could remember the title, but one of the things that it encourages is don't throw away things that could be used another way. And it shows things like Ernie using an old egg carton to store his paperclip collection or something like that. So yeah, reusing is something important. The next song, You Oughta Save Water. I already don't like that title. I really already do not like that title. It's trying to sound cool and hip. And I do like the idea of it sounding like a get back with me again, baby kind of song. But, the melody and the beat is just annoying. Plus, the little things we do already made that point. And heck, in some ways, Energy Blues kind of makes it clear. And did I really have to give that song credit for already doing it? And that song was just as preachy. The song Rainforest, it had the potential to explore what the rainforest was, and I was engaged in what it was at first. It seemed to almost lead us into making our own conclusions. But instead, it barely explores before saying, don't chop down the trees. Thanks for that. If you just described what the rainforest was, without bringing in the literal last-minute message, don't chop down trees. As a kid, I would want to keep the rainforest alive because, obviously, it's home to all these animals. And it provides the oxygen for the animals. It feeds off the sunlight and so forth. And also, minus 20 points to that song because one of the lyrics is, the rainforest helps protect the earth from global warming. Dr. Cox, do you want to take that again?
Wrong, 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 wrong. Wrong, 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 wrong. You're wrong. You're wrong. You're wrong.
It does help produce oxygen, but it doesn't stop global warming completely. It's teamwork. And I get that that's what they're trying to do, but you really gotta emphasize that. It's teamwork. Not just one-sided. You gotta work with nature, and nature has to work with you. It's a way of colliding in a gentle balance. Save the Ocean. This song is just bad for two reasons, aside from its propaganda, obviously. First of all, they already made this point in a previous song. And number two, I could barely make out what the words were other than the chorus. How are you supposed to teach kids when you could barely make out the words? This is important. I'm adding a third point in there. Explain! Explain how to save the ocean. Don't just say, do it. Because if you just say, do it, everybody's going to wonder, how? How can I save the ocean? If you said something like, pick up trash from the ocean, or if you're going fishing, just make sure the hook doesn't fall off the line. There! You're starting with how to save the ocean, or don't randomly spill things into the ocean because it's bad for the environment, and if you do that to the ocean, this is how it's going to affect you, so and so forth. And I'm just going to add a fourth reason as well. This song just literally spells out the words.
A-G-L-O-V-E, the O-C-E-A-N.
Love the ocean.
You got a S-A-V-E, the O-C-E-A-N.
Save the ocean.
Come here, guys. Are you listening? Are you listening? Okay. Let me just make this clear. Literally spelling the words out does not necessarily make the situation cooler. Kids are capable of understanding. Just give it to them straight. Be truthful with them. If you expect the kids to be truthful with you. Fat Cat Blue saved the river. Well, I'm just going to let Henry VIII take this one. I tell you, I like it not, and now I like it much worse. The music is swallowing up the lyrics in a way that I cannot hear them. This is so bad, and I don't even know what the motivation is.
Ooh. Little Betsy, those fish lay their eggs upstream.
The dog ain't going to swim in that river.
They can't swim up the river.
Hey there, Skipper! That slime blooming everywhere!
Yeah, and Urban Zoos is okay. It's not terrible, but I just don't care for that chorus. I think it's among the least bad of the album. Solar Power to the People. is absolute propaganda. I can understand where they're going with, but not everything works through solar power. A few things can, but for the most part, it doesn't work like that. This song's worst crime is that it fails to explain that. Maybe I'm wrong, but solar power cars, how does that even work? If a car gets solar power only, how's it gonna operate at night? Maybe it does, maybe you could tell us in the comments. The problem with this song is, along with it being absolute propaganda, it doesn't explain how to get the solar power in order to come up with these really great ideas. It just spouts off great ideas and that's it. This is directed at little kids, and I don't know about you, but as a little kid, I wouldn't even care about it. What do you guys think? Would you care about it as kids? Movie fan?
Well, at that time I was in high school, so it may not really apply to me. But either way, no.
Joshua?
Two words, Bonnie.
Absolutely not.
Alpha?
The last time I had any interest in solar panels as a kid was on the 4th of Neverary. In fact, I didn't even know the dang things existed until I was in 5th grade.
Yeah, I thought so. Windy and the Windmills. Well, actually, this one is the best of the album.
What?
Yes, I said that, guys. This one, actually, I think is the best of the album. For one, Jack's singing it, and he's really got a very nice voice. While it does talk about pollution, but it does it in a way that makes the point stronger. It also talks about how the wind helps. This is actually a song that educates on how, why, and what. It answers all of the questions that I think any quote-unquote propaganda should, especially if they want to make their point. While I don't think this song will ever go on my top 10 best list ever, it does fall into the okay category for me. So this is actually a good one. And then we come to the one that, in my opinion, is the absolute worst Earth Rock song out of all of them. This one actually enraged me. Don't Be a Carbon Sat Squash is what it's called. And one of the reasons that it gets on my nerves is because all it does is just call you a sat squash. It guilt trips you for, well, take a listen.
First you turn on your computer and play games for hours and hours. Don't you know some chimney's spewing smoke to generate that power? Then you turn to television, but you leave the PC running. Your share of greenhouse gas adds up to a number that's quite stunning. You gotta learn what to do and what to watch. Don't be a carbon Sasquatch.
A smaller footprint means less pollution.
The only thing I like about it is that it's catchy, and these singers are really good, but it's calling us a sat squatch. Thank you so much for the guilt trip. For me, this was a personal problem.
It's time for soccer practice, and Mom will take you there by car. But are you sure that's what you really need? Hey, the field is not that far. You could run or walk to soccer practice and keep yourself in shape. And then the car won't burn that fossil fuel, letting greenhouse gas escape. Your breakfast, lunch, and snacks and dinner have consequences too. With packaging and refrigeration, you're gonna need a bigger shoe. We buy so much imported food that comes from oh so far. Try the farmer's market and get some food that's grown right where you are. So now you know what to do and what to watch to keep from being a carbon Sasquatch.
Where do I begin with this? Number one, okay, yes. I mean, if the field's not that far, yeah, let your mom take you to that field. But other times, people need to use a car because depending on how far the field is. I wish I could walk to work. I wish I could ride a bicycle to work, but I live tucked under a highway, and the only closest thing that I've got to walk to is a Ford dealership. So I have to drive my car to work. I've got no choice in that. I even have to go to the grocery store in my car. So Thanks for the guilt trip. Also, yeah, it's better to go to the farmer's market than it is to constantly buy processed food, but sometimes we have no choice because it's not cheap like processed food sadly is. Do I want fresh food? Obviously, yes. But some things cannot be helped in that manner. Number three, this is a song directed for kids. Why are you guilt tripping kids over something that their parents could switch around? Oh wait, it's because you want the kids to switch the parents around. On the one hand, yes, there are some things that parents need to change in their behavior, in their attitude, and so forth. But the kids aren't always aware of what's going on with the parents or why the parents aren't able to do certain things. And it's not because they're carbon sat squatches. It's because of the environment that they are stuck in. Can you change your environment for the better? Maybe you could change a few things around as best as you can and work up to it, but you cannot tell them to jump from the bottom stairwell to the top of the stairs. You have to climb your way up, and this song seems to encourage you to jump all the way to the top. And that's just not fair to the kids, and not fair to even guilt trip the kids over some things that they cannot help. And then, last but not least, the three R's. For me, the start of this song really sounds more like a math problem than it does earth rock. It almost seems to be more about how three is the magic number. Oh wait, what was that song again?
Three has a magic number.
I'm sure it'll come to me. But yeah, and it goes talking about each letter of the R. So right from the start, even in the chorus, the song is just not focused. So that gets minus 10 points. And then it talks about reduce, reuse, recycle without explaining how to do each. You can talk about what to do and why to do it. You also need to talk about how to do it. And that is my biggest problem with this entire album. It talks about the what and the why. It never talks about how to take those steps. And that's my biggest problem with earth rock. You want to tell us to change the environment, save the environment? Tell us how, step by step, and help us to understand it. Because if you try to water down the lyrics or even make them not that understandable for a kid, guilt trip us over something that we necessarily cannot help, or even guilt trip a child just so that they'll guilt trip a parent, then you're not going anywhere with it.
There's no denying this album really stinks because of all the propaganda. And the songs, oh boy, most of them, they really are just garbage. That's the truth. I still say all of them are garbage, but hey, to each their own. But it's also because so many things are done in so many wrong ways. Bonnie, you pretty much just covered it all. And just recently, I got reminded that back in the 90s, we used to do this sort of thing all the time. Yeah, when I was little, they tried to basically teach the idea of not littering and recycling to us kids back then. And I was reminded of this quite recently when I went to the Comic-Con. I met an amazing lady, Teresa Cassidy. She was a big part of my childhood because she hosted the Fox Kids Club in my area. And I got her CD, and there is a part where she actually takes a song, Fly Like an Eagle, and turns it into a rap song against littering. Yeah, seriously, take a listen.
By trash and pollution.
Look in the mirror, you'll see the solution.
It's time.
I know.
It's time.
Past time.
To take a stand against this crime.
Stand up.
We can't stay on this hopeless path, or the earth will be totally covered in trash.
It's easy. Why can't we just see?
We can save the planet. It's up to you and me.
Now, you can say what you will about that, but you gotta admit one thing, folks. It is trying to impress the idea of not littering and at the same time recycle. But it's also not cramming it down your throat. It's not treating you like an idiot. It's trying to be, well, decent about this. It's trying to educate you, but at the same time, it's also trying to get the idea across. And it does it in a good way. Probably the most important thing about this song is how they present it. Because with the Carbon Sasquatch, they're basically saying, it's your fault. It's your fault. It's all your fault. Whereas for this, they're saying that you can be the solution. That you can solve the problem. Which is a way better approach than saying, it's your fault. Now, I won't deny that taking the rap approach probably wasn't the greatest idea, but I can't help but chuckle at this because I'm thinking to myself, oh man, that was so 90s. It really was. Either way, it's a hell of a lot better than this.
2/3 of the world is covered with ocean, and human pollution makes a big commotion.
Because at least with what she did, it's trying to get a point across. And I think it does a better job. We need a lot more stuff like this. And that pretty much wraps up the worst list. But we're not done yet, because next week, we are going to be talking about the top 10 best. And you know what? We're probably the first ones to do this who are not in any way associated with Schoolhouse Rock. I can't wait to share it with you.